Thank you for joining the cruise. God bless you. Let's pray again. Lord, you are the sower of the good seed, the word of God. Make our hearts ready and sow into this the soul of our soul, so that, Lord, we will bear fruit for you in abundance. You know that you cannot make mistakes. So, Lord, please go ahead. Break the stony ground, remove the thorns, break up the fallow ground, and sow your seed into good ground. Lord, we wait for the seed. In Jesus' name we prayed. Amen. Thank you so much again for joining us. This is again the Discipleship Cruise. It's a program on air that seeks to introduce to us the matter of discipleship, the matter of training. And we have been on it for quite some time, and we are taking example of discipleship relationship just to elucidate on the concepts and the nature and the conditions and so on that we have learned. So please go on with us. Discipleship is God's only method of building his church, in case you don't know it. So I will build my church. When I build my church, the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. When God builds lives, he builds his church. When God does not succeed with a man, the gate of hell will prevail against that man. That man will not stand the test of time. That man will not be able to stand in his position, in his generation. Discipleship is God's sole method of making men to conform to the image of his son, Jesus Christ, so that they can become usable instruments in his hands. Discipleship is God's way of preparing you to play your role and to make your contribution to the body of Christ and to do what you have entered the kingdom to do. And we have seen that everybody in the Bible who became something in the hand of God, they passed through a discipleship. God said to Abraham, leave your country, leave your father's house, leave your kindred, and go to land I will show you. I will bless you and make you a blessing. God took Abraham to the house, God took Moses to the house of Mr. Jethro. And after 40 years of preparation, God put a rod in his hand and said, I'm sending you to Pharaoh to go and release my people from captivity. Every man, every woman that became a person of note in that generation had to pass through training. In the olden days, when we were children and adolescents and youths, training was normal. It was normal. And when I talk about that, you may be thinking I'm talking about Christian training. No, I'm not talking about training to become a minister or training the Christian training. No, I'm talking about training generally. It was normal. Home training was normal. To learn how to do household chores was normal. There were no servants in those days. When you went to school, it was normal to cut grass. It was normal to learn under pressure. It was normal to attend church every time it was time. We are trained that way. It was normal to trek to school. It was not a big issue at all. It was normal to learn how to thank your parents when they give you money. Nowadays, when parents give money, you ask them, what is this one for? You don't care that your parents are slaving to make ends meet, and yet they are trying to give you something. But you are not grateful. Now, we learn so many things then. But what we are talking about now is deliberate, conscious training with a syllabus, with a behavioral objective at the end of it. God needs to do this now. This is the omission that God wants to bring back. The terrible omission. Discipleship became a lost art for several years. And the situation was the dark ages of the church. As we are coming into the new day that Jesus says he will do for us, is insisting that tie me down the ass. I want to ride them into Jerusalem and do what I want to do. In every facet of life now, what God is doing is to tie down men. If it doesn't succeed, of course God can never fail. It will mean that revival will tarry. But I know that God is already succeeding with you, even as you listen to the word of God. Looking at Ruth and Naomi, as we began to explore discipleship relationships. And today I come to chapter 3 of Ruth. We have seen the entry point. We have seen that they went together, fellowship, relationship. We have seen that God brought her into a definite field. We have seen the definite speakings into her life, the training she went through. We have seen the temptations she was exposed to. That's part of the exposure of discipleship. In discipleship, there's a graduated exposure. They send you on errands. They give you a chance to do something, certain things as you are growing, is graduated. They allow you to be exposed so that we know how you will behave. God knows all that. And now we are coming to chapter 3. And I will just read again. Maybe I should read from verses 1 to 13 quickly. Then I will take a few more issues of discipleship, and I will be begging God concerning me and yourself that our life will not be wasted, that the enemy will not be given a chance. When a life has not fallen into the hand of God, the enemy has a chance to do his wicked will in that life. It will not be so with you, in the name of Jesus Christ. Chapter 3 verse 1 said, Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said unto her, My daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? And now is not Boaz of our kindred, with whose bedings thou wast? Behold, he winnoweth barley tonight in the threshing floor. Wash thyself therefore, and anoint thee, and put thy raiment upon thee, and get thee down to the floor. But make not thyself known unto the man until he shall have done eating and drinking. And it shall be, when he lieth down, that thou shalt mark the place where he shall lie. And thou shalt go in and uncover his feet, and lay thee down. And he will tell thee what thou shalt do. And he said unto her, All that thou sayest unto me, I will do. And she went down unto the floor, and did according to all that her mother-in-law bade her. And when Boaz had eaten and drunk, and his heart was merry, he went to lie down at the end of the heap of corn. And she came softly and uncovered his feet and laid him down. And it came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid and torn himself. And behold, a woman lay at his feet. And he said, Who art thou? And he said, I am Ruth, thine handmaid. Spread therefore thy skirt over thy handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman. And he said, Blessed be thou of the Lord, my daughter, for thou hast showed more kindness in the latter end than in the beginning. Inasmuch as thou followest not young men, whether they are poor or whether they are rich. And now, my daughter, fear not. I will do to thee all that thou requirest. For all the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman. And now it is true that I am thy near kinsman. Howbeit, is a nearer kinsman than I. Tarry this night, and it shall come, and it shall be in the morning, that if you will perform unto thee the part of a kinsman, well, let him do the kingsman's part. But if he will not do the part of a kingsman to thee, then will I do the part of a kingsman to thee. As the Lord liveth, lie down until the morning. And she lay down at his feet until the morning. And she rose up before the before one could know another. And he said, let it not be known that a woman came into the floor. But the Lord had blessing again to his word in the name of Jesus Christ. The Bible said, we must not neglect to do public Bible reading. This Bible is beneficial whichever way you look at it, whichever way you come at it, whichever way you want to experience it. Even reading it, I've told you before, is a great pleasure. There's no book like this. It's not just for your head, it's for your heart. So read this, study it, practice it, let it become your treasure for life. Let it be your light and your lamp. It will shield you, it will protect you, it will make you successful in life. Friend, at this point in time, I want to say to you that discipleship has an end. Well, discipleship is lifelong, doesn't end. But at the point in time, discipleship gets to a stage where we can say there's an end. It's not that you're going to free yourself from your discipleship relationship, but it's going to enter into another level. Discipleship has an objective. Discipleship has what it wants to achieve. So at this point, after they have stayed there for some time, I don't know how long the harvest lasts, but they have stayed for some time, they lived together, they woke up together, they did quiet time together, they read Bible together, they ate together, they prayed together, and they were growing together, they were associating. Then Naomi said, her mother-in-law said unto her, my daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? It could have been very profitable for Ruth to stay with Naomi forever. Naomi needed somebody in her old age to serve her. But Naomi was not a selfish woman. Selfishness and discipleship, they don't go together. That's why before you enter discipleship, you must deny yourself and take up your cross daily and follow Jesus. Even though it was profitable for her, that Ruth will stay with her permanently and be going out and bringing food, he said to her, my daughter, and that's the relationship. Let me say it again, discipleship is a relationship. Daughter, mother, father, son, master, servant, master, apprentice, teacher, pupil, all these are different sides of the relationship. And relationships can grow, relationships can be fostered, relationships can be enhanced. And when relationship work well, when that ship is going well, and Jesus becomes the captain of that ship, oh my God, it's quite interesting, and the result can be wonderful. Two are better than one, but there's a great reward for their labor. Exclusivism, individualism is the bane of many. Independence. But I see these two people now tied together. After months of going together, years of staying together, years, months of going together in Bethlehem, they are now intimate. And I'm praying that your relationship, your discipleship relationship with your human discipler will be intimate, because it also shows you that as it's intimate, that's how your relationship with the Lord Jesus is becoming much more intimate. Paul said that I may know him, I may progressively become intimate and more closely acquainted with him. That I may know the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, if possible, that I may be made conformable unto his death. That I may know him. It's in the discipleship relationship that you know a person. I can't know you from afar. There are many people who are close to me, but they are not close enough for me to know them. If they say, I died, they say, right, something concerning me, they may not write more, they may not know what to write, because they don't know me. We're not intimate. There's no intimacy, there's no closeness. And it's an assumption to think that you know God. It's an assumption. You may know about him, but you don't know him. It's only in this relationship, as the relationship goes on. And at this point, Sister Naomi was very burdened. Shall I not seek rest for thee, that you may be well with thee, my daughter-in-law? Even though you are very profitable to me, but it's time for me to release you. I want your profit. I want your benefit. I want it to be well with you. shall I not seek rest for you? So discipleship seeks to bring us to our rest. It's trying to bring us to our inheritance. It's trying to bring us into what God has ordained concerning our lives. That's the ultimate. It tries to bring us to the place where we can make our own, we can contribute our own quota to the things of God. No longer a child, tossed to and fro, but becoming mature in the Lord, speaking the truth in love, growing up to become like Him in all this, so that we can be able to contribute what we have been fashioned to contribute. We are born again unto good works, which God has foreordained that we should walk in them. Then, we did bad works for years. It's now time to do good works. And as we walk with God daily, day by day by day, we enter into all the good works, all the opportunities, all the good things God has meant for to flow out of our lives. We are supposed to be the people that are making light, the people, the lot of people around us to be excited, bringing light, bringing salt, flavoring the environment. But when a man does not grow well, so you see at this point, you say, shall I not seek rest for you, that it may be well with you? Maybe I should read for you Matthew chapter 11, and then I'll go on. Shall I not seek rest? A correct disciple, a correct parent, always seeks the good of their children, of their disciple. That's why discipleship is so good, because there's nothing selfish. In fact, a disciple will like his children to become greater than himself. He's not doing it for his own interests, so that he can become great. No, he's doing it and pouring into the life of others, so that others can get to the place where God has ordained for them. Friend, I want to keep praying with you. I want to keep trusting God with you. 11:28. Matthew 11:28 says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. You see two rests. So discipleship deals with bringing you to rest, bringing you to establishment, bringing you to a place of no longer struggling. Number one, ever before you even enter discipleship, you must have rest from sin. Rest from some demonic manipulations and manifestations in your life. And when you come to Jesus, say, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Jesus is the rest giver. God has appointed him unto such. And when a man comes to Jesus genuinely, he takes away the load of sin from him, and the man can stretch forth and have rest. If there is a yoke on your neck which is unbearable, he breaks that yoke by the reason of the anointing. He's the anointed. That's the first thing he does. It's after that he says, take my yoke. He gives you the invitation, two invitations. Number one, come unto me. Number two, take my yoke unto you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. So there's a physical outward rest. Now there's a rest for your souls. Hallelujah. Take my yoke upon you and learn. And be discipled by me. Learn me and be discipled by me. Learning is, discipleship is a learning. Learning Jesus. Learning from Jesus. If a man say he's a disciple and is not showing you Jesus, that man is not doing well. Because you can only become the person you see. When you see him, you shall become like him. So a good discipler, a good pastor is always pointing people to Jesus. He doesn't have any other person. He doesn't even speak about himself, except his own example will help you to see Jesus the more. Every discipler that is a correct discipler is transparent. You see through him to see Jesus. Doesn't block your view of Jesus. Because if you don't learn Jesus, you will not become meek and lowly. You will not acquire the kingdom lifestyle. Meekness, lowliness, humility is strange to human beings. There's a false humility. That's not what we're talking about. There's a pretense, trying to create impression with others. But a genuine humility, a genuine meekness, not weakness, meekness, Only comes by learning Christ, because that is the character of Christ. And you can only become like Christ when you learn Christ. And when you really, really, really become meek and lowly, you shall find rest for your souls. There are many souls that are restless. There are many souls that are restless. They are in a state of motion all the time. They have not come to zero, to rest. They are agitated. They are afraid. They are always worried. They live in fear and agitations. How will I eat tomorrow? How will this come? How will this come? How will I do my wedding? How will I do this? How will I do that? They have not rested. So for a man to find rest for his soul, that's an objective of discipleship. And then there's a yoke. There's a placement. There's a place God wants you to serve in. When you finally reach there, then you have reached your inheritance, you have reached your final rest. And all this, God does it. And your disciple, like your Naomi, is concerned about it. When I go with young people, my concern is, will they get there? When they begin to be truant, when they begin to misbehave, I'm asking, will they get there? When they are not committed to what they are doing and they are not going steady, I say, will they get there? Will the potter succeed with these lives? It becomes my concern. Friend, I want to beg you again to take what is you are doing seriously. Don't joke with discipleship. Don't be a truant. Don't play tricks with this critical matter of life. You need to come to rest. It needs to be well with you. Discipleship leads to a rest. Discipleship leads to rest in the soul, leads to the rest of inheritance. And I want to beg you, it doesn't last forever. The discipleship relationship continues, but at different levels as you grow. There's release at every level, until you come to your place of rest and you enter into the purpose of God for your life. And like Naomi, every good pastor, every good disciple seeks that his word, his disciple, may become all that God ordained for his life. Even if he's going to be greater than you, that should be your prayer and that should be your desire. The man that discipled Moses, Mr. Jethro, came to see Moses. Jethro had a church of maybe a small village. Sometimes when he calls prayer as a priest, no more than 10 people. Moses was a pastor of 4 million people. According to size, you cannot compare their two ministries. But Moses always came down to bow before his father-in-law. And the man will still counsel him about his family, about the work he was doing, because you will need that kind of relationship all through your life. Somebody you can run back to when there's a need to pray with you, to discipline you again, to share with you again, to instruct you further. But now, you need to enter your own rest. And I pray you will come to that climax. And time has run out again. Time has run out again. But I wish you follow the story as we read it. Now we began to give her definite instructions that Boaz is our kinsman, our near kinsman. He's in his field where you used to serve with his maidens, and he has known you. Now tonight he's going to winnow barley in the threshing floor. That's where they thresh floor and winnow it. What happens is that you must go there. Don't go there and expose yourself. Go there when he has drunk and he's beginning to sleep. Note where he's lying down. And go and open his loincloth and lie on his leg. How will Ruth ever know this if it's not Naomi who connected her, who told her? There are some things you cannot know. There are some things you cannot enter. except you're in a discipleship relationship. Let me say it again to you. I'm not just saying this to you to frighten you. There are some things, there's no way you can enter such except through a relationship. Eh? Wash yourself. So take these instructions. Wash yourself. Anoint yourself. Put your raiment. Get thee down to the floor. But do not make yourself known to any man until he shall have done eating and drinking. Open his skirt, lie down there. I wish you can dwell on this. Wash yourself with the word of God. Be clean. Let there be no spot or wrinkle or blemish, nothing in your life. Wash yourself. Anoint yourself with the Holy Ghost. Beg him. You need it. And this does not come the first day you came to discipleship. At the stage, God begins to pour the oil on you little by little. Put on your raiment, your robe of righteousness. Eh? Clean robe of righteousness. Let your garment always be white. And go down in humility to the threshing floor. Oh my God. Critical instructions. Only a disciple can give you this. This is a counsel that you need. And many people don't know it. That's why God posted you somewhere. And I want to end. And she said to mommy, all that thou sayest unto me, I will do it. Implicit, prompt obedience. Lord will bless you and keep you. I am praying for you that you will take these instructions critically, seriously. Don't be a truant. Don't come today and then you're absent forever. Take it steadily so that God can finish his work in your life and bring you to the expected end. Father, I thank you because I know that you are walking by your word. There are several people I see that you want to bring them to their rest. There are several people that have come to a point of confusion where they don't know how to go forward again. They have been in discipleship for long, but they don't know how to go forward again. I pray that at this point in time, Lord, as they wash themselves, as they anoint themselves, as they put on, oh God, the raiment, as they humble themselves and obey instructions, that I will lead them into the purpose of God for their lives. Lord, please, God, that the labor of discipleship will not end in a confusion. It will end in a definite positioning and placement. In Jesus' name we prayed. Amen. Amen.
The Sabon Tasha Kaduna. Telephone numbers 0814-408-9412, 0805-845-5719. Email address threshersteam@yahoo.com, or you could visit our website at www.threshersteam.org.ng.